I had a call this morning from Dequeen. She woke me up, actually. I had a late night, and I really could have done with that extra hour in bed, but she was quite insistent. She said she wanted me to write her a poem. Well, I was surprised, quite frankly. I would have expected her to have got one of her lackeys to approach me on her behalf. But she explained that they were just to try to persuade her to use Carol Ann Duffy instead. She wasn't really all that keen on her stuff. She thought she was a tad overrated, and anyway, she hadn't been her choice for laureate. But then, who asked her what she thinks? She told me that if it had been down to her, then it would probably have been a toss-up between John Hegley and myself. But I probably would have got it, because Hegley's a little bit too working class, what with his having been brought up in Luton and all. Apparently Philip would have got his money on the till of the stockbroker, but she'd had to explain to her old man that he wasn't really a murderous fascist psycho who knocked out the odd rhyming verse between foreign invasions, so then he'd come down in the Duffy camp as well, and that had clinched it. She asked me if I wouldn't mind popping over to chew the cud over a pot of Earl Grey. She said she had a packet of custard creams on the go, so I said I'd be round in a jiffy. But I asked her if she could write me out a permit, as it's all residents and rich bastards on the mail these days. So she told me not to worry, I could stick it in on the drive, just tuck it in behind a sentry box, and it'll be fine till about five when she changed the guard. And anyway, she was hoping I'd be finished by then, because she'd got that Banksy coming round to do her a mural for the servants' Kazi. Again, he wasn't her first choice, but he reckoned he could be in and out in half an hour and she wouldn't even know he'd been in. Now, she liked that, she said. She had enough pomp and ceremony around her to last her a lifetime. All she wanted was a quiet life these days. She no longer had the patience for these personality daubers who insist on taking 18 months over one constipated mugshot for a stamp or a coin, Rolf Harris. You don't happen to do pictures as well, do you? She asked. That'd save an awful lot of buggering about. I told her I'd have a go, as long as it was cash in hand. She ruminated on the state of her empire as she sipped her tea from her favourite mug, the one with Charles and Di Royal Wedding souvenir stamped on the side, which was by now showing the telltale signs of dishwasher abuse. I've got one of those fucking MPs coming round later, she said, munching on the last of the biscuits and dunking it in her tea as she spoke in an imitation of an Eton old boy's voice. Please, would it please you, ma'am, to allow me to form you a new government and all that shit. Apparently, he's just won one of those prole competitions to find the smuggest toff to lead the country into its next war. I've a mind to say no, actually, she snorted, choking momentarily on a crumb that had become wedged in the royal oesophagus and spraying regal phlegm across the tablecloth. She poured herself another cuppa, cautiously sniffing the milk before offering me a refill. They're all just a bunch of money-grabbing bastards, she moaned, lining their own pockets at the expense of the poor. I wouldn't trust a man jack of them. She took her crown off and gently placed it down on the table beside a Ming Dynasty teapot and massaged her temples. What this country needs, she spat vehemently, is a right fucking shake-up. She pointed a silver spoon at me before delving back into the sugar bowl. What would you do in my position? I've waited my whole life for this moment. Everything I've ever done has been leading to this situation. I puts down me God Save the Queen commemorative mug with a picture of her Madge with a safety pin through her nose and folded me arms. I'd gained her confidence through my easy charm and approachability and my ability to rhyme my way out of most affairs of state. She was as sick of people bowing and walking backwards out of rooms as I was with the whole unfair and antiquated system of heraldic monarchy that she represented. I leaned in towards her conspiratorially in case her kitchen was being bucked and heard the warning growl of a corgi from underneath her chair. I'm glad you asked me that, I says firmly, sensing that I'd read the signs correctly and that she was hanging on my words. I'd bided my time. I'd played a long, cool game. There was no need for bloodshed with my particular brand of revolution. Fuck 'em, I says with a nonchalant shrug. We don't need politicians telling us how to live our lives while observing an entirely different set of rules themselves. We should all be in control of our destinies, I explained hypnotically, answerable to our consciences alone. I'm liking the sound of that, says the Queen, slurping her dregs and slapping her mug down on its doily, which caused the jewels of her crown to jangle in tune with the crockery. Do go on. Dissolve the monarchy, I says. Abdicate the throne and then pack yourself off to somewhere sunny and enjoy your retirement while you still can. "But what about Philip?" she asked, with vague concern. "You leave him to me," I assured her. "I'll see that he gets a fair trial." And that, ladies and anarchists, is how I will single-handedly bring down the system and replace it with an anarchist state through nothing more than tea, biscuits and poetry. My time will come. Thank you.